And today, in preparation for next week, when we hear about the miracle of Pentecost, which takes part in the second chapter of Acts, we're going to hear from the very beginning of Acts. So we've been skipping around quite a bit, and now we're going back to the beginning. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up to heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Here ends the reading. So this is the beginning of the story of the church. The first sentence starts with, in the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning. The book that he refers to, the first book, is we now call the Gospel according to Luke. So this book of Acts is written by the same person who wrote the Gospel according to Luke. And Theophilus is Greek for lover of God. So this book is addressed to a disciple that he refers to as Theophilus. And he says, in the first book I wrote about all Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven. So he's referring to the book of Acts, and now he's like, that's chapter one. This is the part two. And then he goes through and kind of sums up what it says in the gospel, that he died and was resurrected and convinced the disciples that he had a bodily resurrection. And then we come to the book of Acts. And the book of Acts, it begins with Jesus basically telling the disciples that he's not going to tell them sort of the details of what's going to happen, but they'll receive the power of the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus basically, I guess we would call it, levitates, and a cloud comes in front of him, and they don't see Jesus again. And so bodily, Jesus leaves the disciples, and he just kind of leaves them there. And then some messengers... They say two men in white robe, messengers of God, whether they're angels or whatever. They say, why are you standing here looking up for Jesus? He was taken up from you into heaven, and he's going to come the same way as you saw him go into heaven. And that's it. So that's the beginning of the book of Acts. Kind of a strange place to begin, especially for us modern people. We don't think of things the same way that people did in Jesus' time, I think. We don't, when we think of heaven, when they thought of heaven, they thought of the world as flat, and they thought there was like a dome covering the world, and then stars were in the dome. And so heaven was maybe up above the dome. Well, we know that's not how things are. So when we think of heaven, we think of maybe another dimension. We might refer to it as beyond the veil. So we don't think of heaven in the same way that they think of it. So when we think of Jesus leaving, we don't think of Jesus going away in the same way that they do. So what does it mean for us? I think for us, it means basically the same thing that it meant for the Christian all that time, of the Christians all that time ago. They were used to Jesus being present. They were used to Jesus being their friend. He ate with them. He walked with them. He talked with them. If they were having disagreements with each other, he settled the disagreements. He was there for them the way a loving parent, perhaps a mom, is there for us. And then he wasn't. And he said, I'm leaving you the Holy Spirit. And so I think maybe it's kind of appropriate that this is the reading on Mother's Day, because many of us have had that experience of having a mom or having somebody in our life like a mom who took care of us, who taught us things, who we could count on, maybe we depended on. And then the day came when that person is no longer here. Perhaps they died, perhaps we were separated in some other way. And it's a confusing time. It's a difficult time. It was difficult for the early Christians at first. Who is going to be the final judge of what happens? Who's going to decide where we go, what we do? And how is the Holy Spirit going to help us do all that? It was very mysterious to them. They were frightened. They were confused. Just as when we go out on our own, away from our homes, away from our moms, sometimes we're frightened and we're confused. So I wanted to talk about that experience of what it is to leave what we've known and go on and make our own way in the world. Because I think that's what this story has in common with the experience of mothering and motherhood. And I wanted to tell two stories. The first story I wanted to talk about, and I'm going to have to try to condense it as much as possible. It is a story I heard on the radio many years ago, and it is the story that convinced me to become an adoptive mom. I had always been fascinated by adoption, and this story really kind of convinced me to go ahead. And when you hear it, you're going to be maybe surprised. It's a story of a young man who came to be called Daniel Solomon. Until Daniel was 7 years old, he slept sitting up because he was placed in an orphanage in Romania at birth, and there was another kid in the crib with him, so there wasn't really room to lie down. He doesn't remember a lot about his early years, but one thing he does remember is he didn't spend a lot of time yearning for a family. He didn't imagine a mother and father that would come in and rescue him from this place, because the whole idea was kind of foreign to him. There was one crew of workers that would take care of him during the day and another crew at night, and he didn't really get attached to any of them, and he didn't really get attached to the little boy who shared the crib with him for 7.5 years. And then a lady named Heidi Solomon was starting to consider adoption with her husband. They lived in a Cleveland suburb. And she's a special education teacher, and she thought that if you can do something good, you should do it. So she knew that sometimes kids who came into families who were older, who were adopted, had some struggles and some troubles, and she thought she could handle it. She thought because she could handle it, that she should do it. So they went ahead and they adopted this little boy from an orphanage in Romania. And at first, like maybe the first 6 months, things went pretty well. The boy would have Daniel, now named Daniel, now their son, he would have some tantrums and he would struggle, but he was learning English and he was making progress. And then March rolled around. And on March, they celebrated his birthday. And he was very confused by that because he didn't remember ever having a birthday before. And the whole idea of a birthday was overwhelming to him. So he started thinking about what he refers to as biological things. Until his 8th birthday, he never confronted the idea that he had been born. Therefore, he had parents. People who could have, had they elected to, given him a birthday party sometime before his 8th year of life. And the whole idea really upset him. So Heidi did her very best to explain the difference between biological and adoptive families. But Daniel didn't get it, because he wasn't hearing with his mind, he was hearing with his heart. So he became very, very angry, and he began to hate his adoptive parents. He couldn't let go of it. He began tantruming from morning to night. Heidi says, one time he gave me a black eye when I was trying to help him, and he smiled like he was so happy that he gave me a black eye. So she knew that he needed help. At one point, they had to hire a bodyguard to stay in the house when she was alone with him because she was most of all angry at his mother. And at one point, she was told by at least 2 psychiatrists that her son would never love her. She was told she should put him into foster care. And it started to affect their marriage because she just didn't want to give up and he wasn't sure if it was possible for this boy to ever be like a son to them. At one point, she was making a snack for him after school and he grabbed a knife from the counter and held it to her throat. So, she was told by the psychiatrist that he was homicidal. And yet, she loved him. She loved him because, she says, he was my son. I mean, you have to love him, or else there's no way out of it. She said, it's like if you're lost, you want to keep moving forward to get to the end place. I don't think I ever questioned my love. The only time she did question whether or not she should keep Daniel with them was when she thought about the possibility of him hurting somebody else. And that fear became more pronounced when she met a young man who was older and had been through a similar circumstance as her son, and this young man seemed to be doing well, and then he killed somebody. And so she became very concerned. And so that is when she decided that she had to do something drastic. And so she and her husband and Daniel went through attachment therapy together, which is a specialized kind of therapy that is recommended for young children like Daniel, regardless of their age. That helps them to learn how to attach to other people. And he did pretty well, but then he hit his teen years, and he started stealing stuff, and getting in trouble with the law, so they put him through attachment therapy again. At this point, he's in his teens, and the idea behind attachment therapy is you didn't go through the steps that you needed to go through to learn how to form bonds with other human beings. The way other human beings form bonds is if somebody is nice to you, then you feel good feelings towards them. And these kids have trouble making that connection. So in attachment therapy, they the person who needs help with attachment learns to be dependent on somebody else and to form a what they call a trust bond. It's like, this person feeds me every morning. I can trust that the next morning they're going to feed me again. And if the person who's taking care of them isn't trustworthy like that or isn't caring, then you don't build that trust. So he went through attachment therapy again, and they fed him vanilla ice cream by spoon. They put the spoon in his mouth every night for like a year when he was like 16. And that experience finally kind of did the trick. And so he was coming to the end of his childhood, and he was found out that he was going to get an award from the synagogue, and she had taken him to the synagogue initially because she thought it would help him develop morals. But at first the training didn't take. He spent several years being taken out from the temple in police cars because he was stealing stuff and getting in trouble. At one point he was banned from services. So they saw, his parents saw it as kind of a minor miracle that they wanted to give him an award. And this award, after he got the award, one element of the award is that the winner gets to make a speech in front of the entire congregation. So the confirmants might want to take notes here because he did a really good speech. His whole family was there, and this is what he said. He started out saying, "I spent my first half of my childhood in an orphanage in Romania. So for those years, I had no family, no love, no fun, no music, and no toys." So he talked about his early life, everything he'd gone through since. He did pretty well until he got to the end, and then he got emotional at the end, like I'm doing. And he said, at the end, he said, "Before I finish, I'd like to thank two people, my mom and dad. The reason that I'm here today and the kind of person I am today is because of you. Mom, I can never thank you enough for all the places you have taken me to. Even when I absolutely refused to go somehow, have fun when I got there. Dad, you're one heck of a guy to put up with a crazy family like this. And you guys are both amazing. I love you very much." So at the end of this whole long story, the interviewer asks, "Heidi, do you feel loved by Daniel?" And her answer is, "Yeah, I feel loved by Daniel." And the interviewer asks her how she feels he loves her. And she says, "I don't think he wants to hurt me. I don't worry about that at all." And that may sound like a strange definition of love, but it just goes to show that love is complex. And a lot of times when we think of love, we think of a warm, fuzzy feeling. But that's nice, but that's not really what love is. Love is doing the right thing for people, and even when we don't feel those warm, fuzzy feelings. In fact, that's a very, very important part of love. It talks about how God so loved the world in the Bible that God gave us Jesus. But then God took Jesus up into heaven and gave us the Holy Spirit instead. And that maybe didn't feel like love at that time, but we know now that it was love. That God wanted us to go out on our own. The second story I want to tell is the story of my mother. My mother and I had our ups and downs, but I don't think either one of us ever gave up on our relationship. And so near the end of her life, one August, we went out for a visit, and my husband and I got so angry at my mom that I cut the visit short. I did it as politely as possible, but I did cut the visit short just to say, you know, I'm only going to put up with so much. And I came back to Connecticut, and I waited a week or two, and then I called my mom, and I said, you know, when we were out there in the summer, we talked about you maybe coming up in the fall for the Riverton Fair, which was kind of the big thing in the town where I was a pastor at the time, and see the fall colors and all that sort of thing. And so my mom came for the fair, and she spent the long weekend, and she seemed a little tired, but it was okay. I cooked for her. We had nice talks. We had a lovely visit. Was maybe our best visit, like in the, you know, one of our best visits ever since I had moved away from home when I was 22. And so she went back to Ohio, and then about a month later I got a phone call in the middle of the night. And we all know what the middle of the night phone calls are about. My mom had wanted to talk to me, and they told her, no, you can talk to her tomorrow. And so she passed away without, she got to talk to my dad and brother before she was taken in the helicopter to the heart hospital where, you know, she died midair. So she didn't get to talk to me. So we went through the funeral, and I'm a pastor, so I know how to go through the motions of all that and just get through it and get through it. And then a year passed and another year, and I really hadn't grieved or mourned. I just was okay with it. And then Mom came to me in a dream. And she said, how long since I've been dead? And I told her, I think it was 3 years at the time. Kind of surprising to me. And she said, I'm always there. And then I remembered that my dad had given me Mom's wedding ring. And it was in a little table by my nightstand. And she had said, I'm right next to you. I'm right there. And I remembered the ring. And the ring was right there. So in the morning, I got up, I put the ring on. I still wear it every day. And what it reminds me is that love is so complicated, but it doesn't end. Relationships don't end with death. So the relationship between Jesus and his followers didn't end with death. It evolved. And the relationships that you have with people, they don't end with death. They continue. Relationships continue as long as love is alive. So, on this Mother's Day, and on the days that follow, remember that love isn't always going to be smooth or easy or fun. But it's always there for us. And love isn't really something that we feel, although sometimes we feel loving. Love, more than anything else, is something we are and something we do. So now I'd like to invite everybody to pray, mostly so I can stop crying. God, we thank you for the gift of love. You've sent us here to learn to love and to be loving and to teach people to love. And people are imperfect. But no matter what people do to us or say to us, we know that you always love us. Lead us to love the way you would have us love. Amen.